We are glad you're with us on this Sunday morning. I'm Mike Colombo, and this is Postscripts. Each week here on the show, we discuss news and politics of the week with our news partners at the St. Louis Post-Dispatch. I'm joined, as always, by Christopher Ave. He is the national and political editor at the Post. Our first topic this week is the announcement Tuesday by U.S. Attorney General Jeff Sessions that the Trump administration would phase out the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals program, better known as DACA. That program allowed people brought to the states illegally by their parents to register with the government and pay a fee, allowing them to stay legally and work in the United States. President Obama set up the program through executive order. President Trump and his administration say that was unconstitutional, now putting the ball in Congress's court to craft a legislative solution, or the program would end in 6 months. To dig into that topic with us, we have Post-Dispatch Bureau Chief Chuck Rosch joining us from the nation's capital. Chuck, this week both Republicans and Democrats said that something should be done to help those affected by DACA. The question for you is a bipartisan solution possible in 6 months?
Well, anything is possible in 6 months in this town, but on the other hand, anything is also not possible. And it depends on how the package comes to the floor and how it's presented. If it's attached with things like border wall and that sort of thing, you're going to get widespread Democratic opposition to it. If it has something that has border security in it, but maybe not the border wall in and of itself, you may be able to pull over some Democrats and Republicans together. So it'll be interesting to see kind of how this works through.
All right, Democratic Illinois Senator Dick Durbin and Republican South Carolina Senator Lindsey Graham leading the charge on the Senate side. Both spoke out on that issue. Here is some of what they said.
We are now in a countdown toward deportation for 780,000 protected by DACA today. For those young men and women across America, I can tell you this is a moment of great concern, great fear, and great anxiety.
From a Republican Party point of view, this is a defining moment. We need to create a process forward to fix a broken immigration system. Starting with the DREAM Act kids, I think, is a good down payment on what will eventually be a comprehensive solution to a broken immigration system.
Citizenship in mind, will share a tweet that was sent out by President Trump Thursday morning. This tweet apparently coming at the urging of House Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi. The president said this: for all of those who have DACA there in quotations that are concerned about your status during the six-month period, you have nothing to worry about, no action. So, Chuck, it seems here that the president is in some ways at odds with his own decisions.
Well, I mean, yeah, that's what it appears to be. And on a technical sense, it's not exactly 100% accurate what the president said. If you have your DACA status, going under in the next 6 months, and if you don't apply in the next, in the next month, they gave a month, I think, till October 5th as the sort of the demarcation point for people to apply for a renewal of that status. Then you could be in big limbo in March if the Congress doesn't act. The one thing I will also point out in those very careful lines that the Senator Durbin from across the river in Illinois said and Senator Graham said was, in no way did either one of them mention the wall. And the wall is an issue in this thing. There for Republicans to go along with, a lot of Republicans to go along with any of the the DACA reforms that we're talking about, or permanent status, or however it ends up, there would have to be some funding of the wall in there, and Democrats like Durbin are just not going to go along with that.
What do you think, Chris? The big topic here is immigration. Is it smart to group both DACA and the wall together, or is this just kind of what we've gotten now when it comes to this issue as a whole?
Well, I think it might be, Mike, the way forward here. I mean, DACA is something that's very important to Democrats and some Republicans as well. But let's remember here, the Republicans' number one problem with DACA is that it was instituted by executive order. Many Republicans thought that was an overreach, the president basically saying, you know what, we're not going to follow the law here because I say so. Republicans don't like that, even if they do like an immigration system that allows a lot of these folks to stay. So I think that you pair that thing up that's very popular with Democrats against some, or along with, some kind of border security, protection wall, whatever you call it. I think there's a chance here. Now, Chuck is exactly right on this in that Democrats don't want to be seen as going for a wall. They derided the whole idea of a wall all through the campaign. They don't want to be caught dead supporting the wall, but they could support better, more comprehensive security. Absolutely they could, and Republicans could support that too. So it's gonna all be on how deft the legislative leaders are in packaging and promoting this proposal.
Chuck, talk about a plot twist.
It could be your definition of a wall.
Yeah, that's another great question.
That's exactly right.
As far as a plot twist is concerned, this whole Trump-Pelosi element coming just days after the president and some congressional Democrats reached a deal on that hurricane funding and raising the debt ceiling, a development certainly much to the chagrin of some Republicans, as we were just kind of talking there with the immigration issue. You noted in your recent column here that this is the art of the deal presidency. What do you think of what the president has done here this week?
It could be a transformational moment in this presidency. I'm not saying that it will be, but it could be in the sense where the Republicans walked into that meeting by all accounts thinking that they had the upper hand, and they walked out of it thinking that the president had cut a deal with the Democrats basically off their first offer. Nancy Pelosi on Thursday morning after that Wednesday meeting was almost giddy in her her explanation of what had happened and talked about what the leverage they had, when in reality the leverage that the Republicans had probably was more powerful. There was no way that if they would have attached an 18-month extension on the debt limit rather than a 3-month extension on the debt limit, that Democrats would have voted against it, because they would have had to have filibustered hurricane relief, and there's no way they would have done that. So a lot of Republicans are scratching their heads, angry, wondering what's going on now. And, you know, from the beginning of this, this may be the point. This may be where Trump wanted his presidency to go. Keep both sides guessing.
And with about a minute to go here, I want to ask you, it seems every political power play that happens here appears to have some sort of implication on the 2018 elections. How might what happened here this week play into all that?
Well, at the beginning, the Republicans are going to have to vote twice to extend the debt limit before the election year even begins. The DACA stuff, if it doesn't get resolved, goes into that March period where a lot of Republican and Democratic primaries are starting. It was very interesting to see the difference in the way that that President Trump handled Senator McCaskill and calling her out and saying that Missourians should replace her if she doesn't vote for tax reform. And then literally a week later does the about face on Senator Heitkamp in North Dakota and praises her and says what a good woman she is and says that, you know, he hopes that she goes along and votes for his tax reform package. So, you know, it became situational politics in the moments there. And this could be the president that we have.
All right, that is Chuck Rosch in Washington. We thank you for your time, Chuck. We'll see you very soon. Still to come here on Postscripts, 2 St. Louis police officers shot, but the new Blue Alert system was not activated. We'll let you know what one Post Dispatch reporter learned about that program coming up next. Welcome back to Postscripts. It's been more than a week since 2 St. Louis police officers were shot just north of downtown. When it happened, the state's new Blue Alert system was not activated. Post-Dispatch reporter Jack Suntrip asked why it wasn't activated. Jack joins us now via Skype this morning. And Jack, before we get to the answers that you received, give our viewers a refresher course on what exactly the Blue Alert system is.
Well, so it's similar to the Amber Alert system that sends out alerts for missing children, but this is more for law enforcement officers. So if a police officer is missing, injured, or killed, God forbid, the local police department can fill out a form and send it to the highway patrol, and the highway patrol sends out suspect descriptions via highway message boards, text message alerts, and they activate the emergency alert system on TV stations and radio stations to get the word out.
So when you questioned the different agencies about why the alert was not issued in this case, what did you find out?
So I asked the Highway Patrol, first of all, if an alert was issued, because, you know, if you have that question, you may be looking down at your phone and wondering, well, where's my alert during this situation? So I asked the Highway Patrol, and they confirmed that St. Louis Police Department didn't ask for the alert. And so then I asked the police department why not, and they said that they knew the identity of the suspects that they were looking for, and that they're still developing a protocol to kind of issue when to issue an alert when this kind of situation happens.
Did they give you sort of any indication as to if they didn't know the suspect as well, or if they weren't onto a suspect, would they have issued the alert then?
They didn't say anything about that. In this case, the police officers who were at the scene and who were shot were there kind of looking for this guy already. So the police department had a good idea of who he was and who they were looking for after the fact.
Chris, maybe this is much ado about nothing as it relates to this case, but I'm just interested in what the governor is probably thinking. This is a pretty high-profile situation here, the first incident of its kind to happen since this goes into effect. It was a big item for him as he campaigned, and one of the first big-ticket things that he put into effect. What do you think about
that?
Yeah,
every elected leader looks to make a difference, and I think Governor Greitens, as we all know, a former Navy SEAL, he has really become an ally of law enforcement, gone out of his way to identify with first responders, law enforcement in the state. And I think this was very important to him. I think all he really cares about, though, in this case, is getting these local law enforcement agencies the help that they need when they need it. In this case, as it turned out, as Jack found, the St. Louis Police Department didn't need the help right then, and so they chose not to take advantage of this new benefit. Doesn't diminish the benefit in any way. I think, to Governor Greitens' credit, he found something that might help, and who knows, we might be seeing it today or soon.
And we certainly hope not, but you're right.
That's right.
Jack, any sort of indication from police as to when, at least here in the city of St. Louis, they may have their protocols in place?
No, I don't have any indication right now, but I can follow up and ask.
All right, very good. Thank you. That is Jack Suntrip, reporter with the St. Louis Post-Dispatch. We'll certainly be hearing more from him in the weeks to come. Still to come here on Postscripts, St. Louis Mayor Lyda Crewson addressing a city on edge.
Regardless of the outcome in this case, we have piles of data, stacks of reports, and stories from our friends and neighbors that tell us that St. Louis is in need of healing. The worry and anxiety we are feeling today is not without cause, and it did not start with Ferguson. It has its roots in the story of our country.
That is St. Louis Mayor Lyda Crewson. She released that video on YouTube talking about the tensions as the city awaits a verdict in the Jason Stockley murder trial. Fox 2 investigative reporter Chris Hayes has been in the courtroom for that trial and joins us now. Chris, everybody's expecting a verdict here soon. We don't know exactly when, and the mayor was very quick to point that out, that she doesn't know when it may come, but you've followed it every step of the way.
Yeah, it has been titillating from start to finish. And being in that courtroom, it's unfortunate we don't have cameras in the courtroom so that everybody can see what has been happening day in and day out, including the extremely compelling live testimony from the defendant himself, Jason Stockley. I would recommend anybody read the full briefs that the state and the defense has written, which is their complete summary of what their side is. You can find that by opening up the Fox 2 app. There's just a lot to this case, and it's understandable that there are a lot of emotions involved. It's important for people to really look at all of the evidence, because people are going to take different things out of it depending on where they come from in life. And it's just really, that's I think, what's important.
Yeah, it's interesting, Chris. Like you, I've covered a lot of trials over the many, many years in journalism, too many to count, really. But the thing that strikes me is that when you watch an entire trial, there are so many facts. There are hundreds of different pieces of evidence that really you have to weigh individually to try to make a judgment as to what really happened. Oftentimes, this testimony, this evidence conflicts with each other. So I think you make a very good point, and I guess I wondered if you could speak a little bit to the difference between someone hearing a few facts, seeing it on TV or reading it in the paper, and drawing a conclusion, and really going through all that voluminous testimony and evidence presented at trial. There's a difference there, isn't there?
Yeah, I mean, you really nailed it, because right when you think you've got it figured out, there's a twist that comes up, and then you look at it from a whole different perspective, and it really is something in the course of a trial that's going to happen many times. And there are some key points here that were nailed in the testimony of Jason Stockley. I mean, he was up on the stand for hours, and people asked me, was he good? Well, you could argue that the defense wouldn't have brought him up to the stand if he wasn't going to be good. Yeah, of course, he was a strong witness. He was there for many hours, and he was under intense cross-examination. Again, people might take, if they were in the courtroom, they might take from where their standpoint is out of what his testimony was. But you know, there were two key points for me. One was when the state said, well, you had an AK-47 against St. Louis police policy, and they're trying to paint him as a renegade police officer. And he answered that by saying that he was at some crime scenes and had seen some shell casings from weapons that were high military grade weapons. He decided to have this weapon. He knew it was going to violate policy, but he said it was more important to protect his safety and the safety of his fellow officers. He answered that. Now, how the judge is going to take that? Is the judge going to look at that as a renegade police officer, or is the judge going to look at that as a conscientious police officer? But that is one part of just so many different tentacles.
And I think that's one of the elements that makes this case so difficult to examine as a member of the public, is the fact that it certainly appears that there were things that Officer Stockley did that draw into question his perhaps ethics as a police officer, maybe broke some laws even in doing so, but to convict him of murder in this case, it may not fit that bill, and that is why it is up to St. Louis Circuit Judge Timothy Wilson to decide that fate. Explain how having this be a judge decision versus a jury decision makes this a really interesting element of the case.
Yeah, a very interesting call, and you could argue that the defense would not ask for a judge to be the decider unless the defense felt like the facts of the case were on their side. Something that I've heard the defense say countless times to the judge, "Judge, it's not our burden, it's the state's burden." So they have continually reminded the judge that they have to reach that burden. The state has to reach its burden beyond a reasonable doubt. One of the things that was not clearly answered by Jason Stockley on the stand was when he was asked about the recording on the dash cam, when you can hear him say, and he's not denied it, "Gonna kill that expletive, don't you know it." He doesn't deny it. What he says is he doesn't remember the context and he doesn't remember saying it. And so on the stand, what the defense did is painted a picture that it was a very hectic and chaotic scene. He was frustrated. He was frustrated by the way it was going. And maybe there was another context. Maybe the context was, if we keep messing up this chase, he's going to try to shoot at us again, and we're going to end up killing him. That's the way the defense wanted the judge to hear it. But it was not, I mean, he didn't deny it. And that is something that is going to be strongly in the judge's mind without question, because that would possibly go to premeditation.
One thing that can't be denied, the city is tense when it comes to this. Those visions of Ferguson are not far off. Wounds have not healed for a large amount of this city. And that's why we're all sitting and watching and waiting.
I think that's a great point, Mike. The thing of it is we forget when Ferguson happened, you know, I think no one was expecting the level of reaction, protest, and eventually violence that occurred. And I think just like this case, what happened in Ferguson, the death of Michael Brown, it was in a way kind of a test, not so much of the facts of what happened, but a test of the perspective and the background and the personal experiences of people in St. Louis that see it. You know, a lot of people, particularly white people, kind of took the officer's official report quite easily and quickly. Lots of other people who have had negative interactions with police did the opposite. And I think this is the similar case, don't you think, Chris?
Yeah, it really kind of comes down to people's perspectives. And I think it's really important, too, to talk to somebody that may disagree with you or may have a different political
yes.
viewpoint so you can hear that. And that's really what happens in court, too, is that you are forced to hear something that you may not agree with. You're forced to hear something you don't expect. And we need to have those conversations outside of court.
Absolutely.
All right, gentlemen, thank you. I have to cut this discussion short, but we'll certainly be following it. Next here on Postscripts, we'll take a look at what's trending. Welcome back. It's Christopher's turn to take a look at what's trending.
Well, Mike, trending up, free Wi-Fi. The Lambert Airport Commission last week endorsed the idea of giving an hour or more of free Wi-Fi to all the customers there. At the moment, it's 20 minutes. Big complaint, so I say good news for those net watchers.
Trending down.
U.S. Senator from New Jersey named Bob Menendez went on trial this past week for bribery. Menendez's tale is full of stories of high-dollar hotels, liaisons with models and other young women, political favors. Menendez is a Democrat accused of accepting bribes from a wealthy Florida eye doctor.
All right, and one trend to watch.
Trending to watch, the rancor between top St. Louis County leaders shows no signs of abating. County Executive Steve Stenger demanded that the county council fire its auditor. The county council chairman, Sam Page, opposed. They got into it again. This is just going to keep going, Mike.
Yes, it is. We're going to be following it every step of the way.
Absolutely.
Christopher Ave from the Post-Dispatch. I'm Mike Colombo. We thank you for joining us on this Sunday morning. If you missed today's show, you can find it online. Up next, we have Sunday Game Day with Martin Kilcoyne. Have a great week.